Greetings, everyone. My name is Rusty Gray, and I'm here along with my colleague Ben Bodzi to present today's webinar, which is entitled Protected Concerted Activity, the Labor Board's Trap for Non-Union Employers. And before we begin, I have a few logistical matters I want to cover. First of all, you should be able to see a question box on your screen. You can type in your questions there. We'll probably be answering questions at the end of the session rather than as we're going through it, and we'll try to do our best to get to them, but if you'll put your questions there, we'll do our best to answer them. Also, at the conclusion of today's program, we will be emailing out the PowerPoint presentation so that you'll have it. Also, if you need the contact information for either Ben Bodzi or me, you should be able to see a bio section that you can click on if you need any type of biographical information regarding Ben or me. So you can click on that. And with those logistical matters covered, I think we're ready to jump in to the topic. And the topic, again, is protected concerted activity, the labor board's trap for the non-union employers. And let me tell you what we plan to cover today. First of all, we're going to talk about just what is the basic meaning of protected concerted activity. How does the law define it? We just want to give you a quick overview of that to provide context really throughout the entire presentation. Then we're going to talk about strikes and intermittent strikes. And when you think of strikes, you probably think of, you know, union companies, you know, companies that are covered by a collective bargaining agreement or have unions there, and that's only where strikes occur. But this is, you know, we're dealing again in the non-union context here, and we're going to talk about employees' rights to strike and to engage in intermittent strikes. And we have some new developments on that, some very new developments. We're also going to be talking about confidentiality policies and companies. How do those policies that companies have relate to concerted protected activity? Similarly, we're going to be talking about confidentiality of HR investigations and how our rules on protected concerted activity implicated with those HR investigations and things you need to be careful about in that area. We're going to be looking at off-duty access to premises, that is, where employees are coming back onto the premises when they're off-duty. When can they do that? When can you prohibit that as an employer? We're going to be talking about that. We're going to be looking at social media policies and when those are implicated with respect to protected concerted activity and where the danger areas are for employers in enforcing social media policies. We're also going to be looking at rules on solicitation and distribution. What rules can you have on not allowing employees to hand out information in the workplace or to solicit various causes in the workplace? You know, what kind of policies are permitted, what are prohibited? And finally, we're going to be talking about email solicitation, and more specifically, is, you know, can employees use the company email system to solicit support for a union? So those are the basic topics that we're going to cover. And I'm now going to turn it over to Ben to talk a little bit about the basic meaning of protected concerted activity.
Thanks, Rusty. As a initial matter, we thought we would start at the beginning, and the beginning framework for all of the various topics that Rusty just mentioned is the Section 7 of the National Labor Relations Act. And so a lot of employers tend to think, oh, this has to do with unions, it has nothing to do with me. Well, over the last couple of years, the NLRB has placed a greater emphasis on its role in the non-union workforce. And if you think about it, the private sector unionization rate is declining considerably. And so the NLRB has to make itself relevant to the rest of you all. And the way that they're doing it is by beefing up their rules and enforcement of their rules regarding protected concerted activity. So let's talk about the starting point for the various topics that Rusty said that we're going to cover in the rest of this webinar. Section 7 of the National Labor Relations Act, which applies to union and non-union employers, allows employees to engage in concerted activity for mutual aid or protection. That's usually referred to as protected concerted activity. And so you say, okay, what is protected concerted activity? Concerted activity is activity that's engaged in, with, or on the authority of other employees. Now, I can tell you that the NLRB interprets that incredibly broadly. So they interpret that to mean any activity that is intended to incite group action from other employees, or any activity where one employee is speaking on behalf of other employees about terms and conditions of employment. So it doesn't necessarily mean that there have to be two employees involved in the conversation. It could just be one employee involved in the conversation. And it doesn't necessarily mean that the person has to be speaking on behalf of anyone else. They may just be intending to incite other people to join them in their complaints. And that would be sufficient to be protected concerted activity. So the reason that it matters, or the reason that we have to define protected concerted activity, is because anytime that an employer interferes with, restrains, or coerces employees in the exercise of those protected concerted activities, they commit an unfair labor practice. And so the employee or former employee can go to the NLRB, fill out a form that's an unfair labor practice form. And unlike an EEOC charge that many of you have probably had to deal with before, where the end result is typically a right to sue letter, if the NLRB finds that your company has likely committed an unfair labor practice charge, they are going to actively prosecute that case civilly. So it's not a situation where the employee has to then go find a lawyer who will take the case to pursue your company. The NLRB, the government agency, will do that themselves. So that's why it's significant and important.
And they tend to do it on a very fast track.
Yeah, it does move pretty quickly. And one thing to keep in mind about this whole concept of protected concerted activity is that it applies to non-supervisory employees. So if you have a supervisor, who's hiring, firing, directing employees, assigning employees, performing traditional supervisory functions, they're not protected by the laws that we're talking about on this webinar today. So there's a distinction between supervisory and non-supervisory employees, and we're talking about non-supervisory employees here. So one of the contexts where this matters is assessing your rules or your policies. And the NLRB has put out some guidance recently, or in the last couple of years, about how to assess employer policies. And they're looking at policies to determine whether the policy would reasonably tend to chill employees in the exercise of their Section 7 rights. So in other words, whether your policy could be interpreted reasonably to prevent employees from engaging in protected concerted activity. And so they look at a couple of things to determine whether your rule is overbroad. Number one, if your rule expressly restricts protected concerted activities, that's going to mean your rule is unlawful. It's an unfair labor practice. But they also look at whether the rule was promulgated or issued in response to union activity, whether it's been applied to restrict protected concerted activity. And really, the last one, or the last bullet point I'm going to mention, is the one that most people focus on, which is whether your policy would cause an employee to reasonably construe the language to prohibit Section 7 activity. So what that means is if a reasonable employee might construe your policy to interfere with their right to engage in protected concerted activity, that would be an unlawful policy. And as we'll see in some of the examples we're going to cover through the next few minutes, the NLRB's view on this is really broad. So they think virtually anything would reasonably be construed to prohibit Section 7 activity. And we're going to look at some examples of that. But before we get to the examples on that, I did want to mention strikes and intermittent strikes, because this is something that has recently come up at the NLRB. So as a point of background, everyone has the right to strike in terms of non-supervisory employees, whether they're union employees or non-union employees. And like Rusty said, you usually think about the picket line out front of the facility where someone's holding up a sign that has the union's name on it, and that's typically what you think of as a strike. But strikes can be broader, and strikes are a form of protected concerted activity, and a strike can be engaged in by a single employee, and it can be a single employee walking off the job. And so that is considered protected concerted activity. But traditionally, employees have not been able to engage in intermittent strikes, which means you can't repeatedly walk off the job. You can do it once to make a point to your employer. The existing case law says that maybe if you do it twice, that's protected. But if you do it a third time, that's not protected, according to the existing case law. And so if someone walks off more than twice, even if it's to protest their working conditions or on behalf of protest on behalf of other employees, their working conditions, if they do it more than twice, that's not protected under the current law. Well, just recently, actually this month, the general counsel of the NLRB, who is the officer in charge of enforcing these rules, put out a memorandum. And he basically said that he thinks the existing case law does not protect intermittent strikes when it should. And so he wants to increase the ability for employees to engage in intermittent strikes. So this is the test that he's pushing, the test that we have outlined here. He says that an intermittent strike should be protected if it's a complete cessation of work and are not so brief and frequent that they are tantamount to a slowdown. So in other words, the person has to totally walk off. They can't just slow down their work or do a sit-down strike. They have to totally cease their work and walk off the job for it to be protected. Secondly, it has to be something that's designed to exert economic pressure. So in other words, it has to be for the point of, you're not going to have my labor, so hopefully you'll do what I want to improve my working conditions. That's the basic concept of a strike. And the third bullet point here, the employer is made aware of the employee's purpose in striking. So in other words, if you call out sick, you can't come back later and say, oh yeah, I was on strike that day. You have to make it known that you're protesting working conditions. Now, you don't have to use the word strike. There's no magic word that you have to use and say, yeah, this is a strike, I'm on strike. But if someone makes it clear that the reason that they're not working is because they're protesting your working conditions, that would be considered a strike. And what the general counsel of the NLRB wants to push for is that that's protected regardless of how many times you do that. So it's not the rule that we have now, which is, if you do it once or twice, it may be protected, but if you do it a third time, it's not. What the general counsel of the NLRB is proposing is this new standard that basically says, as long as you make your employer aware of it and it is a strike, then it's going to be protected. So that's a new development on the strike front, and strikes are a form of protected concerted activity. And you may think, oh, well, that's not going to happen to me. You know, there's some recent examples that have come up. Some of you may have heard about the NLRB's case against McDonald's, where there's a big issue about franchise, whether McDonald's is a joint employer with its franchisees. All of that grew out of the fight for 15, where the employees were trying to push for $15 an hour, and they walked off the job, and the employer terminated them, the franchisee terminated them, and that's what caused that whole litigation. So it does happen. I was deposing someone last week in a lawsuit, and it was a manager of a retail establishment, and the person testified that this regularly happens, that employees will walk off the job to protest their working conditions. And I was kind of surprised because I hadn't run into that much in the past, but apparently it's more common than you might think. So with that, I will turn it back over to Rusty to cover confidentiality policies.
Great. You know, Ben, it might be helpful too. You maybe give them a little insight about, you know, can you fire somebody who strikes, or what's the rule on that?
Well, that's a good question, Rusty. And what you would look at is whether it's protected concerted activity or not. If it is protected concerted activity, then you can't fire them over it. And if it's not, if it's unprotected, then you could fire them over it. So on intermittent strikes, you know, that's why it matters whether we have the old test, which is you can do it once or twice, or whether we have this new test, because that's going to determine whether it is actually protected concerted activity and whether you can fire the employee for it.
And, of course, if it's an extended strike, you can replace them. That's a general rule. But when they're ready to come back to work, generally, you have to bring them back.
Right. They go on a preferential hiring list, exactly, for any openings.
Okay, well, let's move on to confidentiality policies. And I'm actually going to come back to these examples after I explain this a little bit more. So let's talk in general about confidentiality policies. And first of all, when I'm reviewing policies for a company, for instance, a handbook, I expect to see somewhere among the policies a confidentiality policy. I think a company should have them. That kind of policy can be really valuable, especially in cases where somebody has disclosed some type of confidential business information, like your business plans, for instance. So it's an important policy, but you've got to be careful in the breadth of the policy in light of some recent opinions from the National Labor Relations Board. I'm going to give you some examples. But as Ben mentioned already, is that employees generally have the right to work together to change work conditions. And part of that is they have the right to discuss their wages. They have a protected right. Again, we're talking about non-supervisors here. They have a right to communicate with each other about their own wages and their coworkers' wages. And the idea is that they can, you know, that may help them to get change with respect to their wages or change with respect to their benefits. So because of that right, you cannot have a confidentiality policy that states in it that these non-supervisory employees are prohibited from discussing or communicating about their wages. That type of policy, if you have a policy that says in it, you employees are not entitled to discuss your wages or the wages of employees is confidential, that will violate the National Labor Relations Act and is going to lead to an unfair labor practice charge and something that you'll have to deal with. But so if you specifically say that, you've got a problem. Even if you're more subtle than that, you may still have a problem. And you may remember that Ben just mentioned about if the NLRB sees a policy that they think might reasonably chill an employee's protected activity, then that policy is also going to be in violation of the law. And so what the NLRB says is that if the policy is so broad that an employee would reasonably interpret it as not allowing him or her to discuss wages or terms of, or conditions of employment, that will be a violation of the National Labor Relations Act. You know, one thing you'll see in some of these policies that the NLRB has had problems with is you'll see a confidentiality policy that says employees are prohibited from discussing personnel information, and it's that broad. Or it says you are prohibited from discussing financial information. And the concern that the NLRB has with that kind of language is that an employee would read it and reasonably conclude that he or she is not allowed to talk about wages, and that's what that's what would be prohibited because that's part of the protected concerted activity. So with general language like personnel information being off limits for discussion or financial information, the NLRB kind of views that as a code for wages, discussion of wages or a type of veiled prohibition against discussing wages, and that can be a violation of the law. Now, we do have some exceptions to this. Now, you may have employees who are privy to employee pay because of their job responsibilities, like a payroll clerk. And this particular rule that we're talking about does not protect that person who learns of this information through specific job responsibilities, this doesn't prohibit the company from having that employee keep the information confidential as a result of learning that information through job responsibilities. And keep in mind, too, as Ben has said, and I've tried to reiterate as well, this rule about discussing wages and allowing employees to do it, that only applies to non-supervisors. There's not a requirement that you allow supervisors to discuss their wages, but you, of course, better be sure that when you're applying a rule that they not discuss wages, that they truly are supervisors. I'll go back and give you a couple of examples of how this has come up. From the previous slide, there was a case involving Target a couple of years ago, and the NLRB found its policy to be unlawful. And in that situation, it prohibited the disclosure of confidential information, and then it defined that as any non-public information, and then saying, including personnel records. And the NLRB in that situation said, well, an employee could read this and think that means personnel records means I can't share wages and wage information. And the court found the policy unlawful. Similarly, and this one's actually a little bit different, but in this Flex Frac Logistics case from 2012, in that case, the NLRB found the confidentiality policy unlawful. And in that case, the policy prohibited personnel information from being disclosed to outside parties. So in that situation, the policy actually was a little bit more narrow because it said you can't discuss personal information with people outside the company. And the NLRB said, well, is that a problem? And the NLRB said, yes, it is. And the reason it's a problem is that these employees may want to talk to a union about their wages and whether they're competitive and whether they should organize to perhaps, try to bargain for higher wages. So, the outside party in that context is the union, and that type of activity is protected. That is what the NLRB concluded. Now, if you're going to have, and again, as I mentioned earlier, you need to have confidentiality policies. They're important. If you're going to have them, and you should, focus on the business information in particular being confidential, such as pricing and costs and business plans and business strategies. Those are the kind of things that I think the policy should focus on. Now, we have had, of course, a rash of identity theft issues, and that should create some concerns for you. If you're going to address that in a confidentiality policy, the way I would recommend that you handle it is refer to keeping confidential employee identifying information such as Social Security numbers. You can make it that narrow, for protecting somebody from identity theft. But you certainly do not want to be as broad as saying all personnel information is confidential or all financial information is confidential. That's what's going to be a problem. So that's a little bit about confidentiality policies. Next, let's turn to the confidentiality of HR investigations. This rule is somewhat like the previous one. It's a little bit counterintuitive and contrary to really what was probably a fundamental practice. I know that it's very common to see in harassment policies that we will conduct harassment investigations and it will all be treated as confidential. And it's very common, of course, for companies to conduct, and I'm just using this as an example, harassment investigations. And during that, we'll tell the witnesses, do not discuss this. This is confidential. Don't discuss this investigation outside of this room. You shouldn't be discussing it with other employees. Well, the NLRB has come out against that. Then they've actually what they've said is that you can't have a blanket rule of making an investigation confidential. Totally, so such that employees are not allowed to talk about it. And if you want to try to understand why this might be the case, and again, they're concerned, the NLRB is concerned about that infringing on their right to engage together, employees engage together to discuss work conditions and that type of protected activity. The perfect example would be if you had a harassment situation going and an employee was interviewed about a supervisor who is supposedly harassing another employee. And this witness knew about it, and it had been a problem, and knew that it had been a problem with other employees and thought it needed to stop. That employee may want to go back to other employees and say, you know what, Supervisor Jim is being investigated, and this has been a problem for a long time. You need to speak up. We all need to speak up. You need to make your complaint as well. And that's the kind of thing that the NLRB is trying to allow to happen. They don't want the investigation to stifle employees from being able to join together to try to solve a workplace problem. In that case, you know, perhaps some harassing supervisor. It is not, though, you know, that not, again, you can't have a blanket rule of making all HR investigations confidential, but they can be confidential. And what the NLRB says is that the company has to have a legitimate business justification that outweighs the employee's rights to engage in protected activity. And they said that, you know, you can't just talk about, in general, the integrity of the investigation. That alone is not enough. You've got to be more specific on that. And here's what the NLRB says about how to be more specific on it. You've got to look at this on a case-by-case basis in each HR investigation and whether you can keep it confidential. And in doing that, you have to weigh a few things. You have to look at a few things that might cause the need for it to be confidential. One is, does a particular witness need protection? For example, do you have a witness who, if this information is disclosed about the investigation, that, you know, the accuser, there could be a significant risk that the accuser is going to retaliate against that person, maybe even harm that person. That's certainly the type of situations where the investigation may be confidential. Also, look at, is evidence in danger of being destroyed? That may be a situation as well that justifies the investigation being confidential. For instance, if you're concerned that the alleged harasser in a harassment investigation is going to find out about the investigation and start deleting text messages or other communications, voicemail messages, et cetera. If you have that kind of concern and it's a legitimate concern, that's the kind of thing that can support the investigation not being confidential, being confidential. Also, if you have legitimate concerns that testimony is in danger of being fabricated, if the word about the investigation gets out, you know, for instance, if the alleged harasser in a harassment investigation learns about the accusation and then starts fabricating accusations against the accuser, and this actually happened in a recent case where the alleged harasser found out about the accusations and that investigation was taking place, and the harasser went out and created fake text messages that purportedly showed a relationship, a consensual romantic relationship with the accuser. The accuser actually ended up winning the case, but that's the kind of perhaps concerns that a company have, if they're legitimate concerns, that could support an investigation being confidential if there's a real danger of fabrication. Also, if there's you need confidentiality to prevent a cover-up, you know, perhaps if word gets out that you're doing this investigation that an alleged harasser, for instance, might create an alibi. Well, I wasn't really there on that day. I was actually over here, and so can support that. So those are the type of considerations when the NLRB is considering whether it's okay to have an HR investigation that is confidential. And it's the company's burden to show that these factors that I just described justify or support that the investigation is confidential. Now, quite frankly, I think that burden is probably not going to be too difficult to meet for a company. If you're concerned about this issue, here's what I recommend you do. If you're in an HR investigation and you're thinking, you know what, I really need this to be confidential, I suggest that you document in that investigation file what the concerns are. You know, for instance, you may say, we're concerned about keeping this confidential because we've had situations in the past where this harasser has actually retaliated against people. Or we know there are a lot of text messages here that are alleged to be at issue, and we're really concerned that they're going to be destroyed. That kind of just support in the file. If you paper the file with what you're concerned about, I think your odds go way up for that investigation being confidential. Keep that in mind. All right. Next, I wanted to show you a policy that the NLRB's office, General Counsel's office, has issued. What they will have approved as a policy for confidentiality in the context of HR investigations. I'm not going to read it to you, but you can just, especially when we send this out to you at the conclusion of the program, you might find this helpful to include in your policies about the confidentiality of investigations. But this might be a good time for you to go back, look at your harassment policies in particular, and see what you say in there about confidentiality. And you might want to use this language that the General Counsel's Office has proposed. So that's a little bit about the confidentiality of HR investigations, as well as confidentiality and policies in general. And I'm going to turn it back over to Ben.
Thanks, Rusty. So next, we're going to talk about off-duty access to premises. So employees have a right to engage in protected concerted activities on your premises. And Rusty's going to talk a little bit later about solicitation and distribution policies that are going to govern how employees can engage in protected concerted activities when they're at work. But the question becomes, what about when they're not at work? Do they have a right to engage in protected concerted activity on your premises when they're not there to work? And so the NLRB has a series of rules that govern this. And they have said that off-duty employees have a right to solicit and distribute literature in the exterior, non-working areas of the employer's premises. That's your parking lot, sidewalks, driveway, that area. So an off-duty employee can come onto your parking lot for the purpose of engaging in protected concerted activity. That right applies not only to the facility where the employee works, but also to any of your other facilities. So if an employee wants to go to another facility, to the parking lot, to talk to the employees and try and organize employees there, that would be protected concerted activity. There are very limited exceptions to this, and the NLRB has basically said that you can restrict access for security needs if you can prove a specific security concern. But it's going to be your burden as the employer to prove that security concern. And it's not just generally, I can't have people I don't know on my parking lot. That's not going to cut it with the NLRB. You're going to have to show, for example, that maybe you had a series of break-ins in your parking lot over the last couple of months, and that's why you need to prevent people from coming onto your parking lot. That type of thing would be a legitimate security concern. There's also a carve-out for if employees are causing a lot of litter on your parking lot and you can show that. For example, let's say they're handing out flyers to other employees and they're putting them under the windshield and, you know, the wind is pulling them off the windshield, so you've got all this litter in your parking lot that you've got to clean up. In that situation, you can then prospectively potentially justify keeping employees from coming onto your parking lot. But again, it's going to be your burden as an employer to show why they shouldn't be allowed on your parking lot, and it's going to be a pretty high burden, whether it's a security concern or a littering concern. That's not something that's going to be easily proven to the NLRB, and it's going to have to be based on a specific set of events as opposed to just a generalized, I'm concerned about this happening. So one other point is that they're entitled to go to non-working areas on the exterior of your facility. So if, for example, You run a trucking company, and you know your drivers are out on the loading docks, you know, and in the parking lot doing their work. The off-duty employee can't come up to your folks that are working in the exterior of the facility and interfere with their work. So it's non-working areas in the exterior of the facility. Now, the NLRB says that you can have a policy that limits off-duty access to the interior of your facility if you meet the following factors. So the policy has to limit access solely to the interior of the facility. You have to clearly disseminate that policy to all your employees. And the policy has to apply to off-duty access for all purposes on the interior facility, not just for union activity. And so this came up in a recent case called Sodexo America. And in Sodexo, the NLRB's position is all means all. So if you're going to prohibit employees from coming on to the interior of your facility for any purpose, you can't have carve-outs or exceptions to that. And so in Sodexo, there was a carve-out or an exception that allowed off-duty employees to enter the facility for company business. And then NLRB said, no, no, no. If you're going to let them come on for company business, they can also come on for protected, come into the facility for protected concerted activity. So you need to be very clear that they're not allowed in for any purpose whatsoever in your policy so that you can then enforce it when you do have organizing activity on the interior of your facility. All right, let's talk about social media. And before we get to social media policies, let me back up for a second. We're talking about a lot of employer policies today. And you may be wondering, well, so what if my policy violates the National Labor Relations Act? What's the consequence of it? What does it mean to me as an employer? And so there are a couple of things that it means. If your policy itself is considered overbroad or unlawful, someone can file a charge, and if the NLRB finds merit to that charge, then what you're going to have to do is rescind your policy and post a notice to employees saying, we had an unlawful policy and we rescinded it. And so you say, well, not really that big of a deal. I'll take the risk. You know, some people might take that position, which is a perfectly legitimate position to take. The problem becomes when you discipline someone under one of these overbroad policies, be it the confidentiality policies that Rusty discussed, or the off-duty access policies that I just discussed, or the social media policies that I'm about to discuss. If you discipline someone based on an overbroad policy, then when that person files an unfair labor practice charge with the NLRB, not only are you going to have to fix your policy and post a notice to your employees saying we had an overbroad policy that we've rescinded, but you're also going to potentially have to pay that employee back pay and reinstate them. So that's where the stakes go up tremendously, is when you discipline someone under one of these overbroad policies, or what the NLRB considers overbroad policies. So with that background, let's go ahead and talk about social media. This has been a focus of the NLRB since back in 2012, and they put out a series of guidance memos on social media policies. And, you know, they're looking at these policies through the framework of, would the policy reasonably tend to chill employees in the exercise of their protected activities? And what the NLRB is looking for, what they want to see in rules, are clear examples. And so if you use broad general terms, they're not going to be happy with it, and they might find your policy unlawful. But if you use broad general terms and then you define it and say meaning, and you define it with specific examples, they are much more receptive to the policy if you've defined it with legitimate examples. So let's look at policies that have been found as overbroad because they protect protected concerted activity. And one of the early cases on this was a Costco case. And it was the first decision from the NLRB that invalidated a social media policy. And specifically, the part of the social media policy that they took issue with prohibited employees from making statements that, quote, damage the company, defame any individual, or damage any person's reputation. And what they said is that would reasonably tend to chill employees in the exercise of their Section 7 rights, because they would reasonably construe that as prohibiting Section 7 activity or protected concerted activity. So let's look at that policy. Damage the company, defame any individual, or damage any person's reputation. So the NLRB's position, and this is a really interesting position and aggressive position, but their position is that you can't prohibit defamation, because in order for protected concerted activity to lose the protection of the act, it has to be maliciously false. So in other words, someone has to knowingly or intentionally say things that are untrue. If what they say just happens to be untrue, and it's not knowingly or intentionally untrue, then it's protected concerted activity, potentially protected concerted activity. And so this concept of defamation, remember, the lawyers that are on the phone are all going to remember the famous New York Times versus Sullivan case from law school, which is the one that draws the distinction between malicious defamation that applies to the higher standard for public figures and the regular standard for defamation. That's basically the standard the NLRB is applying. They're saying defamation is not enough. It has to be malicious defamation in order for you to prohibit it. So that's why they found Costco's policy to be overbroad, and that was one of the first decisions that they made on this. Here are some other examples of what the general counsel has said to be overbroad. Disparaging remarks when discussing the company or supervisor. Now, that seems like common sense. You don't want your employees out there disparaging. But, you know, employees have a right to complain as part of their protected concerted activity. They have a right to do that publicly, and you could construe that as disparaging and a violation of your policy. So, therefore, your policy, if it prohibits disparaging, would be overbroad. Also, the NLRB's position is that you can't prohibit employees from posting the company's logo online. And this is a big, big bone of contention. A lot of clients ask me about this and don't understand it. And the NLRB's rationale here is you can prohibit employees from using your logo for commercial purposes, but there are all these fair use exceptions for copyright and intellectual property laws. And so as long as someone's not profiting from your logo or trying to profit from your logo, they have a legitimate right to use your logo as part of their protected activity. That's the NLRB's position anyway. Policy that prohibits offensive conduct or rude or discourteous behavior, unless you're going to define what you mean by offensive conduct or unless you're going to define what you mean by rude or discourteous behavior in a way that doesn't include protected activity, that policy would be overbroad. Prohibition of inappropriate discussions about the company, management, or coworkers. Again, they say that's overbroad. You know, there are examples that you can look at, but these are common sense policies that a lot of employers have. And so the question becomes, what do you do about this? And I think the answer is that you have to really drill down and define what you mean by inappropriate or offensive or disparaging. And if what you mean is they can't say maliciously false things, they can't say things that would violate your harassment or discrimination policy, then you're going to be okay if you're going to define what you mean by offensive or disparaging or inappropriate to mean those things. But if you're just going to put out the general generalized, inappropriate, disparaging, discourteous, those types of things, the NLRB is going to have a problem with it. Similarly, here's some more examples, and I won't take up all your time reading them. You'll get the PowerPoint, but these are other examples of common sense policies that the NLRB says are overbroad. So you may be saying, okay, hold on, you know, every handbook that I've ever seen includes policies like this. What am I supposed to do about this? And there was a lot of criticism of the NLRB for saying what they think is unlawful, but not saying what they think is lawful. And so they came back and they came out with a report where they published this policy from Walmart, the Walmart social media policy, that they had found to be permissible or lawful. And so it's available on the NLRB's website. If anyone needs help finding it, just, you know, reach out to me afterwards. I'm glad to help you find it. But the policy that's on the NLRB's website for Walmart is one that they've said is lawful. And so there's an example you can use. You know, and within that policy, it does tell employees to be fair and courteous. You know, and then, but it comes back and says, nevertheless, if you decide to post complaints or criticism, avoid using statements that reasonably could be viewed as malicious, obscene, threatening, or intimidating, or that might constitute harassment or bullying. Those are unprotected activities. You can clearly, so when they say be fair and courteous, they're defining what they mean. They're saying what we mean by that is don't be malicious, obscene, threatening, or intimidating, or engage in harassment or bullying. So because Walmart was giving those specific examples of what they meant by fair and courteous, the NLRB found the policy to be lawful. Some other things that the Walmart policy prohibited were posts that intentionally harmed another's reputation or created a hostile work environment based on race, sex, disability, or religion. And then they prohibited inappropriate postings, but they went on to define what they meant by that. And they say it may include discriminatory remarks, harassment, and threats of violence or similar inappropriate or unlawful conduct. So again, we come back to this concept that the NLRB wants you to specifically define what you mean by broad terms such as fair and courteous or inappropriate. Okay, these are some other provisions that were in the Walmart policy that the NLRB said was fine. They said it's okay to have a provision telling employees to carefully read the guidelines and ensure your postings are consistent with them, to make sure you're honest and accurate, never post information or rumor you know to be false. Here's another key one. Never represent yourself as a spokesman. Make it clear your views do not represent those of the employer. You can prohibit employees from speaking on your behalf, on your company's behalf, online. You cannot have a policy that says that every time you post something on social media, you have to say, you have to preface it by saying, I do not speak on behalf of the company. They've said that that type of policy is overbroad. But you can make it clear to employees that they're not authorized to speak on the company's behalf. And so that's another point that you can keep in mind for your policy. In terms of tips or best practices, I think we've talked about this generally, but you know, for your confidentiality and proprietary information protections, you need to give examples and definitions, and you need to define it as trade secrets or protectable financial information rather than just generally any type of financial information. You know, you need to put qualifying language when you say don't make inappropriate postings, and you need to clarify that you're talking about discrimination, harassment, threats of violence, and not just anything you don't like. You need to make sure that your prohibitions against false information make it clear that if someone is giving out false information that they don't know to be false, that that wouldn't be prohibited by your policy. and you can require that employees not represent their opinions as that of the organization. So that's generally what the NLRB has to say about social media policies. Here's a key distinction. A lot of people say, well, I just won't put it in my social media policy. I'll put it somewhere else. Well, the NLRB has said, no, you can't do that. So here are some examples of other policies that the NLRB has found to be unlawful, even though they weren't contained specifically within a social media policy. And you can see those, and you'll see that when I send out the when we send out the PowerPoint afterwards, but the concepts are generally the same. So regardless of whether it's in a social media policy or in another policy, the NLRB is going to have the same issue. Before I turn it back over to Rusty to talk about solicitation and distribution policies, I did want to mention one real-life example that I've got going on right now. So I'm representing an employer that allegedly terminated an employee based on a Facebook post. And I wanted to read the post to you all so that you can see an example of how this comes up in real life. And we can use it as an example. So this employee worked at an urgent care clinic as a caregiver at an urgent care clinic and posted to Facebook the following post. Got home just in time to go to bed. FYI, urgent care does not mean emergency care. We close at 8 does not mean you have until 7:59 to drag your ass to the doctor. No, I can't file your insurance if you don't even know what insurance company your policy is with. I cannot diagnose you over the phone or in person for that matter. The nurse cannot read your TB skin test over the phone, and you cannot get a prescription for anything without seeing a doctor. I don't want to work with or around humans anymore. That was the post from the employee. Now, in my opinion, that's a personal gripe. She's not speaking on behalf of anyone else, and she's disparaging the customers or patients of the urgent care center. So our position is, and she says she doesn't want to work with humans, which is kind of a disqualifying aspect of any job. So our position is that's not protected concerted activity. Her position is that was protected concerted activity. You fired me because I made this Facebook post. So that's the kind of example of these issues coming up in real life. Now, this person has filed a charge with the NLRB and has asked for back pay and reinstatement. So that's something we're going to have to litigate, but that's an example of where someone could construe something or try to construe something as protected concerted activity, even when it's not, and you just need to be careful about situations where you're going to take action against someone based on their Facebook post. So with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Rusty to talk about solicitation and distribution policies.
Great. Here I want to address rules about, you know, can an employer prohibit at least some solicitation in the workplace or some distribution of literature in the workplace? The answer is yes, but you have to be careful with it, and you have to have your policy narrowly drawn and enforced. And if you've ever been through a union campaign where a union is trying to win a union election to represent the employees, you'll know that the solicitation distribution policies will probably be the most important policy that you have in that campaign, and it will be closely scrutinized as well, I can assure you of that. So this is something that you need to have correct, and you need to have it correct now. You want to have that in place before it's too late, before you find yourself an election petition filed and you wish you had the policy already in place. But here are the basic rules. First of all, on solicitation, in other words, like employees going up to another employee and, for instance, orally saying, hey, it's cold in here, we're tired of working in here, but under this temperature, let's walk out, let's strike, which would be protected activity. But can you prohibit that type of solicitation? And you can during working time. You know, if employees are out there on the line working during working time, they can't be walking away from their line while they're working and engaging in these kind of solicitation that I just described. What about handing out literature, distributing literature? Well, You can prohibit it from being distributed in the working areas. You know, you might envision the plant with a line operating and somebody handing out, you know, leaflets or flyers. You can prohibit that in the workplace, in work areas, working areas. Also, you can prohibit them from handing out or distributing literature during the employee's working time. Now, you've got to be a little careful with the concept of working time. It's not as broad as just work hours or company time or business hours. It pertains to that particular employee and whether that employee is on working time, for instance, as opposed to a break. As a general rule, if an employee is on a break, that is not working time, even though that's during work hours or business hours. As far as third parties coming onto the premises, companies can prohibit third parties, non-employees, from coming onto the premises to solicit or distribute literature. So if a union wanted to come onto your premises to have employee meetings, you could prohibit that as a general rule. Now, you've got to be consistent on that, though. If you're allowing political candidates, for instance, to come in and speak to employees, and then all of a sudden the union says, well, we would like to do the same, you've got a problem. So you need to enforce your policies uniformly. Along these lines, what about email? Can the employees, during a union campaign, for instance, get on the company's email system and say, vote yes, we need the union because our wages are suppressed, or we need the union because we're not being treated in a dignified manner? Well, until recently, the answer was employees could not use the company email system for that kind of solicitation. That was a case from 2007 that I referenced there in the materials, the Register Guard case. That case has now been reversed by the Purple Communications case. And you can see, it, in many ways, it depends on which administration is in and which, and that has appointed the members of the National Labor Relations Board. We had the no email approach and under the Bush administration and under the Obama administration. It's more employee friendly, and the rule now is that employees have a presumptive right to use the employer's email system for concerted activity during non-working time. Back to that concept that they can do the solicitations during non-working time, and they can use the email system. Now, what the NLRB says, look, email now is essentially the gathering place of employees. It's kind of like a cafeteria in a way, and so they should be able to use it. Now, you do not have to give employees access to the email system if they don't already have it, but if you're giving employees access to the email system, they can, there's a presumptive right that during non-working time they can use it for concerted activity. Now, there is an exception. The NLRB has not spelled it out yet. This is a new area of the law, but they talked about there can be special circumstances where these types of email are prohibited. They talk about how an employer could justify a total ban on non-work use of email, and it'd have to be a total ban. You couldn't pick and choose. And you'd have to demonstrate that ban is necessary to maintain production or discipline. We think it's a very narrow exception that the Department of Labor is, National Labor Relations Board has not explained yet, but it appears to be narrow. The NLRB has said you can restrict use of large attachments, for instance. Something that would, for instance, cause problems with the actual functioning of the system, that would be an exception too.
Sorry to interrupt you, but I was going to make one more point on that. So I'm actually litigating the special circumstances issue right now, and here's a context where it comes up. So I represent a fast food chain, and the fast food chain has one computer in the office in the back of the fast food store that's used for managers to send emails back to corporate, basically, and to put stuff into the computer. And so there's been a charge saying, well, employees should be able to use that for protected concerted activities. And so by prohibiting them from doing that, your policy is overbroad. And so we're litigating the special circumstances right now, saying, look, there's one computer, it's in the back of the store, it needs to be used for production, for work purposes, and so that's special circumstances that would justify a ban on email use.
That'll be interesting to see how that turns out. We've got a few questions I'm going to try to get to just as quick as we can. A number of them have to do with, you know, the employees walking off the job and you know, what's to prevent them from calling it a strike when they really just don't feel like working that day. And you know, how you and another kind of another group of questions have said, well, what if it's somebody who works like in healthcare and there's a definite patient need for patient care? Ben, do you want to take a shot at that?
Yeah, sure. Patient care, there is an exception for that. So even the NLRB recognizes that there is an exception for patient care. And they draw that patient care distinction in a couple of different contexts. But the NLRB does recognize that their outlook on the world can't interfere with patient care. So that is an exception. In terms of, well, what if an employee just feels like they don't want to work that day? You know, it really depends on what they're communicating to you. If they're communicating to you that the reason they're not working that day is because they're fed up with whatever, then it probably could be protected, even if it is that they're tired of working. But if what they're communicating to you is this is to improve our working conditions or in protest of our working conditions, then I think you need to treat it like protected concerted activity. If they don't communicate anything to you and you don't know why they're off, the fact that they called out is not by itself a strike. I mean, you don't have to assume that employees are striking every time they call out. It's if they communicate to you why they're not there.
Yeah. And there was also a question about the confidentiality of investigations and whether that means that the company has to, you know, turn over or reveal, for instance, its investigation notes. And the answer to that is no. What we're talking about with the confidentiality of investigations is when you're telling employees or giving instructions to employees that they can't discuss the investigation out in the facility or among other coworkers. But it doesn't mean you have to open up your investigation to others. Well, we've got many questions that we could answer, and unfortunately we're out of time. We do very much appreciate you taking part in this, and look out for upcoming webinars. We have a lot of exciting topics coming up, and thanks again.